Hello to my online friends. Welcome. My name is Joel, and I have the privilege of serving on the staff here at Panama Baptist Church. Thanks for being with us. There's not a lot in the way of announcements this week. Let me just remind you about these invite to listen cards. These are little business card size things that have the church contact information on one side, as well as the different service times on the other. These are great to just carry around in your wallet or your purse. Put some in the glove box of your car so that if you're talking to somebody about church, you're striving to live deployed, you can put this in their hands. It makes a great tool for something like that. So next time you're in, feel free to grab a stack of these off the welcome desk or email us. We'd be happy to mail you some as well. Let me just mention too, you know, we don't talk about this an awful lot, but if you'd like to financially support the ministry of Panama Baptist Church, you can do that in one of three ways. You can give at our in-person gatherings here on Sunday morning. You can mail a check to the church office, or you can also give through the tithe.ly. Again, you go to the App Store, search tithe.ly, look for the app, download it, then you can search for Panama Baptist Church, and you can give through the app as well. Several people take advantage of that. All right, let me pray to start our time together, then the worship team will come and lead us in a couple of songs. Would you pray with me? Let's do it. God, we are grateful for the opportunity to do something like this. We thank you just for the technology that you've given to us that allows us to further spread your word. God, I pray that you would be glorified in all that takes place. For Pastor Andy, as he comes in a few minutes and continues his series through the book of Ecclesiastes, God, that we would be challenged and enriched through what we read in your word. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, here's the music too.
You are home. I will.
Yeah.
We had some work done on our house recently, and the contractors opened the windows to let the fumes out. Unfortunately, these windows had no screen, so fumes out.
flies in. We spent several days with fly swatters trying to get rid of the flies. I'm not sure that they're all dead yet. That reminds me of a statement, a saying that I brought up in a previous series. It was a line I picked up from one of my professors, Dr. Rick Horne. He said this, open minds are like open windows. They need screens on them to keep the bugs out. And when I taught it in the previous series, we had some hand motions that we used to help us remember this helpful saying. It went like this, open minds are like open windows. They need screens on them to keep the bugs out. I encourage you to say it with me when we do it again here in just a moment. And you can do the hand motions unless you're driving. But here we go. Open minds are like open windows. They need screens on them to keep the bugs out. We do, don't we? We need a reliable filter to let the truth into our minds and screen out the lies and the half-truths, what we're going to refer to as bugs. We are in part 4 in our series in the book of Ecclesiastes. And in this section, friends, there are bugs. And there is profound truth in this passage. So we can't just throw it all out. But we also don't want to just let it all in, right? We don't want to have an open window with no screen on it. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to go through a number of verses with you. And I'm going to try to do it very quickly. I'm going to try to not spend a lot of time interpreting or telling you, is this a bug or not? That's something for you to do. This is screening practice, if you will. So Ecclesiastes chapter 7, you could call this Q says, and by the way, this first section is a series of A is better than B statements, even though a lot of people would pick B. Here we go. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 1, a good name is better than fine perfume. Your reputation matters more than the brand of your body spray. That sounds like Proverbs, doesn't it? Let's continue. A good name is better than fine perfume, and the day of one's death is better than the day of one's birth. Surprise, you're not in Proverbs anymore. Let's keep going. Verse 2. It is better to go to a house of mourning than to a house of feasting, since that is the end of all mankind, and the living should take it to heart. Q says you'll learn more about what it means to live well at a funeral than at a party, right? It's at a funeral when you hear people talk about what really matters, what made the difference in their lives. So you'll learn more at a funeral than at a party. Verse 3, grief is better than laughter. For when a face is sad, a heart may be glad. The heart of a wise is in a house of mourning, but the heart of the fools is in a house of pleasure. It is better to listen to a rebuke from a wise person than to listen to the song of fools. For like the crackling of burning thorns under the pot, so is the laughter of the fools. This too is futile. Q says, you can learn more from pain than from pleasure and mindless entertainment. You can learn more from pain, whether that pain is because of grief or that pain is because of feedback. Somebody told you something. I remember, again, another quote. A guy said, you know, when you receive feedback that hurts, he says, well, I've learned to say, ouch, that helps, right? He said, you learn more from pain than you do from pleasure and mindless entertainment. Verse 8, the end of a matter is better than its beginning. Q says, how you finish matters more than how you begin. My brother is a pastor of a church not too terribly far from here. And one of the sayings that he gave made it onto a t-shirt. I actually own one of them. I love this saying. He says this, your next step is more important than your last. I think you would agree. What you do next matters more than what you just did right before it, because the end of the matter is more important or is better than the beginning. The second half of verse 8. A patient spirit is better than a proud spirit. Don't let your spirit rush to be angry, for anger abides in the heart of fools. Q says patience pays dividends, but pride costs you dearly. Verse 10. Don't say, why were the former days better than these, since it's not wise of you to ask this? Q says, nostalgia is not helpful, right? It's not helpful for you to say, why is Pastor Andy preaching through this depressing book of Ecclesiastes? Remember the good old days when Pastor Joel was here and he was preaching through the book of Ruth and it was like a Hallmark movie and we loved it. It was happy and cheery. Q says, stop, enough already. That's not wise. It's not helpful for you to go getting all nostalgic. Verse 11. wisdom is as good an inheritance and an advantage to those who see the sun, because wisdom is protection as silver is protection, but the advantage of knowledge is that wisdom preserves the life of its owner. Wisdom, Q says, is at least as good as money. Verse 13, consider the work of God, for who can straighten out what he has made crooked? Q says, the world is broken, and God's the one who made it that way. And it's futile to try to undo what God has done, because God's the one who made this world that is so baffling and full of so much tension that we cannot understand. Verse 14, in the day of prosperity, be joyful. But in the day of adversity, consider God has made the one as well as the other so that no one can discover anything that will come after him. I think Q is saying that the good days come from God. And so when you get a good day, yay, thank God. The bad days come from God. So on the bad days, remember that God does that on purpose, gives us good days and bad days so that we will make the most of the present, because you never know what tomorrow will bring. Now, I want to pause before we continue. I told you at the beginning, Q has some profound truths for us, and Q is offering us up some half-truths, and Q is offering up some plain old bugs. We are on screening practice. Let's continue. Verse 15. In my futile life, I've seen everything. Someone righteous perishes in the spite of his righteousness, and someone wicked lives long in spite of his evil. So don't be excessively righteous and don't be overly wise. Why should you destroy yourself? And don't be excessively wicked and don't be foolish. Why should you die before your time? It's good that you grasp the one and do not let the other slip from your hand. For the one who fears God will end up with both of them. Q says, don't be overly righteous or overly wicked. And don't be overly wise or overly foolish. Q, what are you saying? Is Q saying that we should avoid extremes? Is Q saying, hey, don't put all your eggs in one basket. Like, don't put all your effort into being the good boy or the good girl. Nor is it wise to put all your effort into being the bad boy or the bad girl. Is that what Q is saying here? Let's jump down to verse 20. There is certainly no one righteous on the earth who does good and never sins. That sounds right. This is the only verse of Ecclesiastes that is directly quoted in the New Testament. Paul quotes this in the book of Romans. Verse 21, don't pay attention to everything people say, as you may hear your servant cursing you. For in your heart, you know that many times you yourself have cursed others. Q says, don't get all worked up over someone's judgmental comments about you, because you know you've done the same thing to other people. Let's jump ahead to chapter 9, verse 1. The righteous, the wise, and their works are in God's hands. People don't know whether to expect love or hate. Everything lies ahead of them. Everything is the same for everyone. There is one fate for the righteous and the wicked, for the good and the bad, for the clean and the unclean, for the one who sacrifices and for the one who does not sacrifice. As it is for the good, so it is also for the sinner. As it is for the one who takes an oath, so also for the one who fears an oath. This is an evil in all that is done under the sun. There is one fate for everyone. Q says a lot in these three verses. He says, we are all in God's hands. But that's not a comfort, because you don't know whether you're going to receive from God God's approval or God's judgment. He says, but what we do know is that we're all going to get the same fate, and that fate is death. And death is the greatest injustice of all time. That is not fair that the righteous get death just like the fool gets death and the wicked gets death. That is the greatest injustice, Q says. Verse 7, Q says, go, eat your bread with pleasure and drink your wine with cheerful heart, for God has already accepted your works. If you're still alive, Q says, and you have material goods, enjoy them. Because the only way you can still be alive and have these material goods is if God is pleased with you. So if you're alive and you got the stuff, enjoy it, because that's what that means. God must be pleased with you. Verse 8, let your clothes be white all the time, and never let oil be lacking on your head. The oil, this was something you put on for special festive occasions. And so Q is telling us, turn every day into a festive occasion. Verse 9, enjoy life with the wife you love all the days of your fleeting life, which has been given to you under the sun, all your fleeting days, for that is your portion in life and your struggle under the sun. Q says, enjoy your woman. Unless you're a woman, then enjoy your man. But even when Q's trying to be encouraging, and do you know how depressing he is? Like, in all the days of your fleeting life, right? Let's look at one more, verse 10. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your strength, because there is no work, planning, knowledge, or wisdom in Sheol where you're going. Sheol was a name they used for the realm of the dead. They didn't really know about heaven and hell, per se, and so they just assumed there was this realm the dead went there, and they called it Sheol. And Q is saying, whatever you do, throw yourself into it while you can, because you're going to die, all right? You are going to die, and there's no work, there's no planning, there's no knowledge, there's no wisdom in the realm of the dead, so do it now while you can. As we read through those bunch of verses, you probably spotted a bug or two, a statement or two that is just plain untrue. But you probably also spotted a statement or two to which you'd say, well, yes, but, and then you would clarify, you would fix, you know, Q's misconception there. You know, as I think about this passage that we've worked through so far today, Q did us a favor. He gave us screen practice. Now, that probably wasn't Q's intention to give a screen practice, but maybe it was the narrator's intention all along. Remember, there's a narrator who set this up, and then he got quiet after just the first few verses, and he's just been just telling us everything Q has been saying. But we've got screen practice. We've got a chance to try to filter out what Q is saying and let the profound truth come in, but the bugs hit the screen and have to stay out. So Q does that favor, right? Most of the time when we read the Word of God, we just know it's all truth. You wouldn't have to have a screen at all. But Q has given us some stuff where you got to have your screen up. You've got to compare it with the rest of Scripture and see if what Q is saying to you, if his conclusions and his assumptions are true. But through Q, we also receive something else, a sobering warning. One of the things that really bothers me, I find it kind of scary, is you can be a God-fearing, intelligent, and educated person and still end up with bugs and an unreliable screen, and Q proves it, right? Q was a deep thinker. Q was God-fearing. He had the first few books of the Bible, we believe, right? The Torah, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. He had at least that much, and we believe he had a good bit more of the law and the prophets. He was intelligent, he was educated, he was God-fearing, and yet, here he is. There's no indication that he doesn't believe what he's saying to you and to me. He is spouting profound truth mixed with bugs, and it's all coming out in a single stream. And we have every indication that he believes everything he's saying. That the stuff that's coming out of his mouth, he truly believes, which means that he had an unreliable screen himself. He bought what he was selling, or he's selling what he's already bought, I guess is how I should say that. Personally, I want to know and believe only the truth. There are always negative consequences for believing the lies and the half-truths, the bugs. You no doubt want to know and believe only the truth. So you and I, we need a screen. But as Q has just shown us so clearly, not just any screen, a faulty screen. This is so, so important. A faulty screen will let bugs in and screen truth out even. You know, like, that is the opposite of what you're hoping for, the opposite of what I want. A faulty screen will let bugs in and screen truth out. At times, Q screened out truth. He screened out things that he knew by faith when he couldn't explain how that lined up with what he saw in his observations. And the reason why is you know, on the reliability scale, if you will, he placed his observations and his reasoning abilities above God's revelation. He trusted his abilities to see, interpret, understand, and make connections more than he trusted what God had clearly said. It's like the screen for Q was, does this make sense to me? Oh, he believed in God for sure. But it was like that wasn't the most foundational part of the screen. That wasn't the final word, if you will, part of his screen. The final word part of his screen was, does this make sense to me? Can I put this together in a way that I can connect the dots? I can resolve the tension. Because if I can't resolve the tension, if I can't figure out the answers, then that must mean there are no answers. And there isn't a solution to this tension, because his abilities was the final level. It was the final filter for Q. So let's talk about this. Everyone has a screen. Everybody already has a screen. So when I say we need a screen, we already have one. You already have one. I already have one. The question is it reliable? And that, my friends, depends on what the screen is made of. So let me just kind of get nerdy with you for a couple minutes in hopes that I can be really, really helpful, because you and I, man, we want to profit from what we've seen Q demonstrate as a negative example. The typical screen, the screen that I have, you have, most people have, or whatever, the typical screen is made up of two things. You just like when you think about a screen, you got some threads going this way, you got some going this way, those are held together, and that makes your screen. Typical screen is made up of two things. First is the meaning I've made of my experiences and my feelings. The meaning I've made of my experiences and my feelings. Let me try to illustrate. I went through something pretty terrible 20-some years ago, and it was a big-time breakdown. And so that's what happened. That's not the screen. The screen forms when I make conclusions, when I make meaning of those experiences. So in the thing that happened to me 20-some years ago, the meaning I made of that was this, that the reason we had this big crash, the reason for the breakdown was because I wasn't smart enough to figure out how to put everything together and keep it from breaking down. And so the meaning I had that led to both the breakdown, but also got reinforced through it, and that has become part of my screen and is still there if I'm not careful, is this: I'm not smart enough. If I was smart enough, I would figure out a way to avoid the painful things that come into my life. If I was smart enough, I could figure out how to protect my family from everything. If I was smart enough, I could make it so this church would thrive and all of you would thrive and the name of God would be worshiped and we would be growing as a church and growing in our influence. Does this make sense? Now, hopefully you're looking at it and going like, what? Like, you don't agree with me. I'm not asking you to agree with me. What I'm trying to point out is the meaning we make of our experiences, or the meaning we make of our feelings. Like, I'm feeling this way, and that is because, and that requires me to do and avoid or whatever. That's what I'm talking about. The meaning that we make of our experiences and our feelings becomes part of our screen. It is the screen through which we evaluate everything else that comes at us. Another not positive experience for me, another negative example, I guess, is a few years ago, in my family, we had, you know, the bad Andy birthday. I have a system. Pastor Joel has talked to you about my systems before, you know, and so I'm like, as I hear my family members talk about what they might want for Christmas or birthday, I've got a way I write that down, and then I tend to shop pretty early when I've got my list and everything. And so I'm very proactive about that. I had a birthday, and it was not their fault, but the way it played out, I had done some things and the ball got dropped. And so on my birthday, there was no birthday celebration and I didn't get any presents on that day. And it really wasn't my family, but I was sad. But it didn't let it stay there. That sadness kind of went to like pity, like woe is me. And then over time, and this is all subconscious. It's not like I ever sat down and figured this out in the moment or thought it through. But over time, I was like, you know, I don't think they care as much about me as I do about them. I don't have to tell you what happened when that became part of my screen. All right, you don't need much imagination to figure out that this doesn't go well for them or for me. Because now if I believe that, I've allowed that to become part of my screen, that they don't care as much about me as I do about them, my family that is, then the next time somebody in my family does something, I interpret that through that grid. Like, oh, they did this because they don't care as much about me as I do about them. And what I now saw happen that I've now interpreted through that grid only reinforces that grid, and that screen gets thicker. And that belief that they don't care about me as much as I care about them becomes more firmly rooted. Typical screen is made up of two things. The first is the meaning that I make of my experiences, the meaning I make of my feelings, the conclusions I come to about myself, about others, about God, my situation as a result of that. That's half the screen. The other half of the screen is this: the values, the assumptions, the practices of my family of origin, the people in my region of my country, and the tribe that I'm a part of. By tribe, I just mean the people that I hang with. We're Americans, right? One of the assumptions of America is that bigger is better. One of the assumptions of America is that rights are more rewarding than responsibilities. I hang with a bicycling group. So obviously, you know, I hang out with people who believe that cycling is great and the weather is not so much of an issue, right? So cycling is great when it's hot outside. Cycling is great when it's cold outside. And so all of you sane people are like, it's too hot to ride. We look at you and like, ah, wimps, right? Or all of you who are like, it's too cold to be out riding. And we're like, ah, toughen up, right? Why? Because these are the values, these are the beliefs of my tribe. So you got two things, right? The meaning that we make of things and the values and assumptions and practices of our social group, if you will. Those things go together, and that's what typically makes up the screen. Maybe that's obvious to you, maybe that's new to you, but here's what's not new. This screen that we fabricate may or may not be reliable, right? It may or may not be reliable. I gave you a couple examples where it wasn't. Other times it's been very reliable. It depends. It depends on what it's made of. So here we got a screen, right? Made up of these two things. Now, if a thought or a sermon point comes along telling me what God has to say about me or about God, or about my situation, or about the people in my life, if that thought or that sermon point comes along, it hits the screen, and the screen determines whether it gets through or not, aka whether I choose to believe it and act on it or not. It's like the screen becomes the final authority, even though it came from the thought is something that God said. You see how dangerous that is? That's what happened to Q. But it doesn't just happen to Q, it happens to people like you and me who love God, but aren't carefully paying attention to the makeup of our screen. So let's go there next. According to God, the only fully reliable screen is made up of two different things: what God said through Jesus in the Bible, and who God is. What God said, Jesus and Bible, and who God is, like the character of God. Like, we know that God is just. So no matter what happens, we interpret what happens through the fact that I know God is just, and justice will prevail either now or in the future, right? God is present. So it doesn't matter what I feel like. God must be here because God is faithful. He can't be absent. Right, that kind of thing. So the fully reliable screen, according to the Bible, is what God has said and who God is. And so now, when a thought comes along, whether it's a thought that comes at me because of an experience I just had, or a feeling I'm feeling, or something that is part of my culture, or something that my social media group is telling me that, and it doesn't matter whether it's something that, like, they're telling me that I am smart or stupid, right? I am wonderful or awful. It doesn't matter whether the thought is telling me that the most important thing that I should do with is, and fill in the blank. Or if the thought is, the greatest threat to my well-being is, fill in the blank. Whatever the thought, when it comes, it hits the screen. And the screen determines whether it gets through. In other words, whether I choose to believe it or not. And with this fully reliable screen, when the thought comes, Andy, you are, or Andy, the most important thing you ought to be doing, or Andy, the greatest threat to your well-being is, or any other thought, it's been screened by what God said and who God is, and therefore, that thought that comes through shouldn't be a bug, right? It should be truth. So let's wrap this up. I'm hoping that we will screen what Q says. This book is in the Bible for a reason. I want to benefit from the profound truth that Q is sharing. Q is saying some amazingly profound things. Q is saying things in a very provocative way at times. They're just kind of like, whoa. You know, it's like getting slapped upside the head. They're like, whoa. At the same time, I don't want to swallow a bug. Been there, done that. I'm also hoping that we'll not just screen what Q says, but we'll take a look at our screen. What really has the final say in our lives? Is it our interpretations of our experiences? Is it the stuff that we've soaked up from the people around us? Is it our feelings? What is it? Or is it God's character and God's insight? What has the final say? What really, when push comes to shove, what is my screen? What is your screen? Boy, I hope that we'll take a look at our screens as a result of listening to what Q has to say. We'll see you next time.
Thanks for being with us this week. You know, as you wrestle through life, as Q did, just in praying that God would remind you of His blessing and presence throughout this week ahead. May you find His gentle mercy in the everyday trials of life. Let me close by reading Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 and 23. Because of the Lord's faithful love, we do not perish, for His mercies never end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. If we can help in any way, you just need somebody to talk to, you've got some questions about some things that you've heard, just need somebody to pray for you, we would be honored to talk to you. Please feel free to reach out to us, send us an email, give us a phone call, set up a time to stop by and chat. We'd love to do that. Until next week, Panama Baptist Church, you are deployed.